that's an approach that we take. We don't do it through a particular official curriculum like you do. We do it through publications and through social media. And what we say is that AI is affecting every single day. If you look for a job post, it might be targeted for men only, for women only. You might be ranking, your financial reporting and your credit score might be impacted for those algorithms. And if we don't take a look at those, you might be undergoing discrimination. So those are the stories that we tell to people. But of course, it's a quite challenging way, because unlike the Western world, you kind of have to start from scratch and be like, what is an algorithm? What is technology? And then kind of build up governance.
Actually,
from there.
You raised another question, because if there are another missing guest in institution is like how big corporations talk to their citizens. I think that Facebook talks to U.S. citizens, to U.S. Human rights protecting organizations, from Access Now, Electronic Frontiers Foundation, something like. And he's a bit responsible. At least you can get some information of which decisions are made on censorship in United States. Actually, I do know that Facebook have a great moderation center here in Africa, which moderates in African languages. By I definitely know nothing about moderation in Russian language and in Slavic languages. Because even having Facebook manager very prominent who worked for Yandex, working for Facebook and residing in Belgium, we know nothing. Well, we know or a good presentation. So if you are not very well developed democracy, very well developed country with human rights protecting organizations, not just ISOC, or internet rights protecting organizations, huge corporations like Facebook, like Google, will not respond to you. So it's also missing institution which you need to regain. Another Russian example is Yandex. So Russia have it's Google, Amazon, Apple, Netflix in one company. And it's completely, it's they even don't start talking about human rights. They're responsive for presidential administrations. They have a direct phone line from presidential administrations, presidential office, whatever else. So they removed content from searching like this. But they do not responsible for, well, wider audience and human rights protecting organizations.
I mean, I can...
Again, dear audience, please join us. So if you feel issues and such in your countries, please tell us.
I just jumped in, by the way. I said, you know, we come from
you
Turkey
also. To join this
So when it comes to big technology companies, actually, if you even just look at the user agreement that you see on your screen, it's just six font Times New Roman thing, which is not understandable at all. But it is by design. Anything that technology companies do and do not by design. And when we look at their responsibilities, we should always remember that these are multi-billion dollar companies. They have every single resource to hire the best people, just put a team of 1,000 people and immediately start working. So even if they are not starting working, it is also by choice as well. So what we see is that, just like you said, in the United States, they're quite responsive for democracy and everything, because there's a lot of visibility and also PR issues at present, right? So when the news channels are saying there's an intervention to 2016 elections, Facebook immediately put up the policy that, you know, they're going to make political advertising transparent from now on. However, it is quite hard for Russia, for Turkey, for actually any country to make our issues relevant, to put public pressure, because Turkish government doesn't have any say, any other government doesn't have any say on how these governments are going to operate. So there's a huge impact there. There's a lot of media literacy issues. So the question comes down to how do we make Facebook and Google and those big tech companies accountable for the policies that they're doing. And I feel like unless we as civil society and as academics and other sectors, unless we come together, we won't be able to communicate with them what we're saying. And as an ex-Google employee, I can definitely say that there is organizational problems or lack of willingness to kind of address these issues. Because once they start taking responsibility, it means that they have to start taking responsibility everywhere. Of course, internet government is tough, and you can't kind of apply every single law everywhere. But they have to start. Just one basic example is that, so for example, when you give an advertising about employment or your financial records, in US you can't do micro-targeting on advertising. So in the US, it is illegal to say, you know, I wanna hire a secretary. I want it to be a girl between 20 and 25 years old, and I want her to live in this area. So you can't do this targeting through advertising in the US. And Instagram knows this. So they come up with a rule that says, you know, you, and so they ban it. But they don't ban it anywhere in the world. But Instagram knows that they should be doing it. So I feel like we should push for more governance and more implementation. And again, I feel like these big tech companies have to do a lot more when it comes to educating the users, and especially in countries like us.
Yeah, it's not interesting for big companies, actually. I would like, please join us. Yeah, so...
By the way, you know, after the start of the war in Ukraine, Facebook was recognized as an extremist organization in Russia. So it's in the list with the terrorist organizations like, I don't know, the ISIS or Taliban or something. It's in the same line with Facebook. Please.
Just a little comment, yeah. So I would not agree with the term of media literacy, because I think media literacy is much, much narrower scope than human rights, that understanding the good governance and the politics. The example which Andrei gave about Facebook, actually, the start of war, very soon Facebook and Instagram becomes extremist activities. Yeah, again, like, but few days ago, Meta was recognized as terrorist organization, the whole Meta.
Yeah, finally.
Yeah, a few days ago, so... We have to be careful. If you are from Meta, we have to be careful to talk.
1, 2, 3. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much for giving me a voice, because I think my vision of these topics would be very interesting for you. As long as I'm from Russia, I live in Russia, and I face all the issues you have said before, like every day. So my organization NPO Dialogue was and is monitoring the Russian media space for almost 3 and 4 years. And what I can say that is from the beginning of war or special military operation, anything useful for anybody, I can say that we have analyzed the Russian media space, and we have known that it is very hard, because from the first day, there are forces who try to polarize Russian society with use of different internet technologies, and the number one technology they use against us is spreading of fakes and disinformation. I'll cover this topic on my session tomorrow, but what I can say is that different forces, they are coordinated. They are coordinated, and they have a lot of resources for spreading and for generating such fakes and disinformation to make people worry, to make people drop all the things and run, to make people emigrate, to make people worry, this I can say, and feel a lot of stress inside of Russia. This is a big problem, because this polarizes our internet society and people, and it is not good for any society at all, in any country. It is very, I can say, it's extremely harmful for people and for their being. So, by the way, there are different forces who try to spread different fakes and disinformation, and some of them are from Free Moscow University, I should notice that. But there are so many forces who do this job. I can say this is a job because they're on payroll. That your colleagues, not you personally, but I should say that your colleagues are only part of them. But it's kind of a minor thing in my speech, because I want to focus on the issue you raised today, and this is the big tech, not like an invasion, but involvement in some social issues in different countries, because we see year by year that they're gaining much more force in actually ruling a country. Because, you know, what is Facebook? Facebook is an organization who could make a revolution in a click. in some different countries because they control the news feed. They control the information which people are like taking every day through their news feeds, through their apps, through their mobile phones and stuff. So that in Russia, we have came to the question of the governmental regulation of what the power Facebook and Meta and all other big tech platforms have. And we have ended up in the law because you've questioned it in before that what should government do to what should society do to make all the things under somehow controllable. Yep. So earlier, I think this year in January, I may be mistaken, but it's not worth the details. But anyway, earlier this year in our country, there was a law presented which obliges big tech companies to open an office in Russia if they are doing some business in Russia, to make a mandatory form of like a feedback for usual people to
mostly for government.
Yeah, no, not only for government, but for usual people. Because if you are a single man and your rights are abused by Facebook, you can't do anything anywhere. You can't mail them, you can't phone them. It's uncontrollable. And this law obliges a company, a corporation, to open to establish a feedback form on their website for the citizens to able to submit some feedback and claims to big companies like Facebook, like Apple, and all the different. So what about the fact that Facebook and Instagram were recognized as extremist organizations? Why it was done so? I should drop some details on that issue, because later in February, we have faced, and February and March, we have faced an informational attack of fakes covering our country. Literally, there were tons of ads, paid ads with fakes and disinformation for targeting usual people. And these ads were saying that grab all your cash, leave your country, go to the streets and protest. These ads were paid, and these ads were supplied to all our Russian audience through Facebook and Instagram. And Facebook and Instagram did nothing to stop it. And it is interesting question because we know that Facebook and Instagram have a huge moderation team in their ads library,
yeah,
and you cannot pass.
Can I finish, please?
And you cannot pass a single ad without moderation. But all these ads were run from fake pages. Once I've checked, you know, the Facebook has an interesting instrument called Facebook Ads Library, and in Russia. Yeah, and in Russia we have a governmental TV channel, Russia 24. And I've checked up this Facebook ads library.
To give a pause.
Yeah, sure.
I believe you can talk the next 45 minutes
I
about
found
the issues of Facebook
in this
Russia.
In this
because
Facebook ads library, I found 16
okay.
pages, fake pages of Russian 24 from which fake ads were run.
Yeah, okay, thank
I
you
finished.
Very much.
Yeah, okay.
I would like to introduce that's Anna Dialog, which this beautiful person presents.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, is actually have close ties to Russia 24. So
we don't have any ties for Russia 24. Yeah.
Yeah, we have.
Yeah,
yeah,
sure.
We have online questions. So, well, Andrey. Well, we have an online intervention. Could you read it, please? Unfortunately, it's in Russian, but well, I think Andrey could read it in English instantly. It's also about it's I think it's about another missing institution. It's about another missing institution in Russia, which usually present another organization. So please.
Okay. We'd like to have a representative of Creative Commons in Russia, Global Net Creative Commons Global Network in Russia, and in concise, he said that there is a lot of more than 10 years. There are 10. They're blocking websites from the websites of the providers without any court decision, and information is blocked. Which is not suitable for Roskomnadzor, for Russian authority responsible for that. Also, Roskomnadzor forced Wikipedia to delete information of the let's say fakes on the matters of the army, on the activities of the army. It's after the start of, let's say, special military operation. Also, we had our colleague said that there is the evidence of arrest of the Wikipedia participant from Belarus. It's making worries of participants, and there are some questions how to protect people, how to protect the quoting materials, and they said that absence of blocking of Wikipedia is official is individual decision. Sorry, is individual decision of one of the person. Also, we have the loss of foreign foreign agents and not desirable organizations. And foreign agent law was created to prevent financing activities of the Russian non-government organization from behalf of the foreign money, and also this law could recognize the foreign agent of any single person on the best desire of the Ministry of Justice of Russian Federation. It's not a question. It's an intervention from the remote participant because he's able to. And also talking about the recharge of Creative Commons of Russia. He's worried about the absence of the Visa and MasterCard and possibility of financing Russian Federation. And there are he raises so question maybe it would be interesting. How to what to do with the foreign agent laws, and is it possible to claim the IGF to reduce the to cancel this status from the people connected with internet governance, and so there is the problem.
Yeah.
So
okay, I hope some of issues will be addressed, but I would like to mention well, from this intervention, it's clear that also other institutions is missing in Russia, because Wikimedia.ru, NGO, have nothing to do with global Wikimedia. It's a strange people who getting money from government and, for example, from some other financing and saying that they we are developing Wikipedia in Russia. But actually, but they are actually not a part of global Wikimedia movement and not always share their values. The same thing but it's also missing Creative Commons global network chapter in Russia. The promotion of Creative Commons licenses is being done not by institutionalists somehow, but by some activists, well, including some courses in Free Moscow University. So I would like you to participate in our discussion. You see, even we are being Russian opposition, we are really welcome Russian Gonda, who is, well, actually working in this area of internet governance. But we heard an opinion from Turkey, but we would like to hear anyone. I see people from Finland definitely here. Everything is good in Finland.
And very nice frog from Finland, I think.
And well, tell about your country if. Voice to be heard. It's usually in ICANN, but I think in IGF it's also. And
MasterCard has left Russia and all the transactions are stopped, and it's true because I had to come here with like a pack of cash because I can't use my bank card here. But it was not a Russian decision to kick out the Visa and MasterCard, sadly.
I will object because it's also in line, well, somehow of this formal, because missing democratic institutions, missing civil society institution led to those activities of Russian governments,
yeah,
programmed organizations who actually led us to this.
I can sum up that.
Again, we want you to speak, please.
But in general, I think...
I see you have interest, yeah? Come in. Introduce yourself.
Experiences internet conflict, as the global knows. But I want to raise here is there is different kinds of disinformation across the global mainstream media with a campaign with different global networks like Facebook and Twitter. The disinformation even that I tried to monitor, and we tried to monitor, especially in Twitter and Facebook, even those who are supporting the interest of the Ethiopian people and state the content that raised in Twitter and Facebook even automatically removed sometimes. But in the contrary, in the other side, the other opponents, I mean the Ethiopian opponents or Ethiopian public opponents, they raised some against Ethiopian people's interest and Ethiopian sovereignty. Such contents are even widespread across all social media platforms like Facebook and Twitter. But the regulation, when we try to report in different way, in different mechanisms, in different contacts, they ignore the interest of the people, the interest of the peoples of Ethiopia. And as even there are different kinds of mercenaries without any much evidence or sufficient evidence, sufficient data, they dispatch different kinds of misinformation against Ethiopia and especially in the region, even in Africa in general. So such kind of the huge high-tech social media platforms, I think they...
Well, may I ask you a question? Do you have human rights protecting organizations here in Ethiopia? So what do they do think about cooperation with huge platforms? Do they cooperate? Do you have special digital human rights protecting organizations in Ethiopia?
I think there is lack of institutions, as you mentioned, but there are some regional offices like Human Rights Watch, and even the Ethiopian government human advocacy office, there is even governmental and UN agencies, they are working on this, but generally there are lack of civic society working on it. But what I try to raise is these high-tech companies must balance it all the information dispatch or disseminate all over the world. The main target must be the information that's based on the right that's important for global citizens. So it must be balanced. This is my idea.
And how is internet? And this instrument was developed at the COVID time. So you can officially say and openly say about COVID only what government says. Now it happens the same thing about special military operations, because colleague once noticed this war, he's under great risk. You can't call it war, you must call it as governmental official. Yeah. I don't recommend you to get back to Russia. Yeah, so how it's in Ethiopia? So government and forces, it's only opinion of things which, or not yet. How is content filtering and blocking implemented in Ethiopia? How civil society and human rights protecting organizations oversee this? Do are any chapter? Do any special, very special Ethiopian-like organizations which exist in Ethiopia and well does not exist in other countries? Like Anna Dialogue is about dialogue in Russia, but well to promote official position. What such organizations are in Ethiopia?
Like
people of organization called MIAL, which is modeled after EFF or ORG. So we are working for internet freedom. And I think there is kind of elephant in the room here, because I recently find out that we tend to think that people are confused or deceived by disinformation. Or propaganda, but I think quite many people actually like misinformation, or want to live under authoritarian regime. I think I'm pretty sure that in Russia, there are lots of people who actually support Mr. Putin. I'm personally developing. Censorship circumvention technologies like I2P or TOR related projects, but I found out that many people actually, Japan is quite good democracy, but I think the situation is the same in the US, but many people actually, doesn't like democracy or actually hate democracy. So my question is, I don't know, I might be wrong, but if you feel the same way, what can we do? Because we can help people who want to see the truth or something, but we can't help people who don't want to see truth. So what can we do?
Well, we have to do something. Yeah, that's where about this meetup. But about elephant in the room, about misinformation, actually this is elephant not for this room. In this room we gathered to talk about missing institution. So maybe you, in this case, talking about how to spread fair information or how to spread different information. I would like to say, well, that's in Russia, the people who, well, there are special people, some of you are just behind you, who getting paid for supporting Putin, yes. But numbers of people in Russia just do not have information about other possibilities. So that's what colleague called fakes. That's all Russians supporting Putin or supporting war with Ukraine. They just do not have other information, because for tens of years, because of lack of civil society working or imitational civil society working with freedom of information, just now there is, for the most of Russian society, there is no possibility to have alternative point of view. There is only one. Yeah, yeah.
Because there are plenty of Telegram channels and opposition web pages, and even Mr. Navalny and his YouTube channel is alive and making a lot of videos. So all the information is accessible to Russian people, and Russian people have a lot of like some different point of views through like Telegram channels and stuff. So we can say that this media space is, I can say it's fair. I can say it's fair because there are multiple points of view presented. So what about your question you raised that people actually like disinformation and fakes?
it was correct, yep. You know, we have made a study, and the key problem of this fact is that usually fakes and disinformation provide you with a simple answer to some tough question. And when you're trying to give the right information, you have to make a lot of effort to pack it to some very simple, some very easy accessible and easy eatable, I can say, format. It's like a video, like some picture, not very long text, because it's very important for consuming the information and the way people consume the information. Fakes always gives us a very easy answer on some big problem. So when we are trying to give people some right information, we have to be even more easy eatable, I can say, easy consumable for these people, to make the information quick, to make the right information a quick path to their heart.
Yeah, actually, question more is a slogan of Russia 24. Well, because they provide simple answers. But I see another one wants to talk. Please pass the microphone. Don't forget to introduce yourself and your location and your issues.
I'm Harry from the United States. I used to work for the World Wide Web Consortium, standards body based out of MIT, a university there. And I would just like to make it's very interesting learning about Russia and Turkey, but I just want to make some quick points about the lack of democratic institutions in the United States itself, and in internet governance in particular. So first of all, a few years ago in the internet governance forum, there was a lot of demands for internet access, which is a very reasonable thing for people to want. Particularly, for example, you had the shutdown of the internet during the Arab Spring revolts in Egypt. What most people don't remember is that during a protest against the Republican Party in 2004, the internet and mobile was also cut off inside of New York City. That, people ask about freedom of speech and freedom of press, but the United States prosecutes Julian Assange, currently in jail seemingly forever, to be extradited for basically publishing what is widely considered human rights violations, which are considered true by the U.S. government. There's no democratic accountability there. And that in general, the United States has a large lack of democratic accountability due to the predominance of the national security apparatus, which in part also controls key functions of the internet ecosystem. The entire invention of the IGF was essentially invented to be a space where people could blow off steam from civil society, while the United States maintains control over ICANN. Similarly, with financial sanctions and financial programs, the FATF, which runs various sanctions and AML KYC standards, this is an undemocratic, opaque body ran by U.S. Treasury with advisories of 13 or 14 banks, all of which are based in Europe.
Okay, so which institution is missing in the United States?
What I said is that the democracy in the United States, from an institutional standpoint, it is you elect a president, just as you elect a president in Turkey, and perhaps in Russia. But the fundamental institutions, democratic control over on the internet, for example, the domain name system, IANA, internet names and numbers, and freedom of speech and freedom of press are actually missing even inside the United States. So I think it's a sort of incorrect dichotomy to put together, to distinguish that there are these kind of democratic countries and non-democratic countries. Because if you go beneath the surface in the United States, anything that involves actual power, you encounter a deep state infrastructure, just as you do in Turkey or Russia. It's just less apparent. And they have much better media and much better propaganda. And you do have some democracy over rules and elections, which are effectively inessential to foreign policy or economic objectives.
Yeah, and how you address such issues in the United States?
Say it again?
How do you address these issues in United States when going to, well, storm Capitolium, or what is your proposition?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's the same problem you have in Russia and Turkey, where civil society is very weak, and the technical people are mostly controlled by a few companies, which are in bed with the deep state apparatus. And there is general, whenever you discuss it, is considered misinformation, right? So it's a problem of popular education and enforcing some sort of real democratic structure, which will probably be multiple generations, if we have it, of social struggle. I don't see, there's not an easy institution. I mean, you would ideally just want some separation of autocratic, technocratic, deep state institutional structures from popular structures, but you don't have that. And I think it's the same problem is in every country in the world.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yes. Yeah, it's interesting. Well, maybe you can name organizations in United States which perform since Russia Today or Anno Dialogue, like my colleagues, who imitates media or imitates civil society to... So like Yandex in Russia have a direct phone number, a phone line to Office of President. Facebook have also, well, direct line to FBI. That's what you say. Okay, thank you very much. Please.
I just want to resolve a couple of stuff, because I think this is quite a tough and really interesting panel, to be honest. But this is exactly what the situation is like in certain societies. And I feel like there's a lot of polarization in Turkey as well, is that, you know, we really can't tolerate each other, and we are both right in certain senses. And when it comes to Turkey, we did elect our president. We do have democratic institutions, but I guess it's quite blurry when, like you just mentioned, you don't feel comfortable saying it's war, but he does. So sometimes you just don't know whether you will be under a certain target. So when we look at laws, these are not implemented homogeneously, because there's law and then there's law enforcement. So the police might take initiative to arrest you, but not him, for quite obvious reasons, I guess. But I guess, like, if we have someone willing from United States to kind of maybe bring his perspective, I'm quite interested, actually. And these are all American companies, Facebook, Google, and we are just third world, I think, for a lot of this. There's an Oriental approach, and they don't invest a lot in policies. I don't feel comfortable a big tech company holding a side in any type of war. Is there a neutral way to do it? Is there a neutral way for content moderation? I would love to hear that discussion, because these are the issues. There's war, there's danger. It's not easy on our end.
Yeah, again, we are not about content moderation, but maybe about institutions which could enforce.
Just like to note one thing. We're talking about the law, but the most the law works actually when the government and NGOs are working on the same rules. But when government works on one rules and civil society have to work on other rules, we have a completely different situation. So we have, for example, we have law in the country, but the law is only written. We cannot rely on this, and we cannot protect our life and protect our rights because of this right, because of the law, written law, because of this lack of judicial institutions maybe in the country that protecting energy, because it's only on the side of the government, only on the side of the government, not nowhere on the side of the civil society. So no one activist, even the foreign agent that was mentioned before, he's not judged out his status. So
it's selective. It's called selective law practice. So I saw Russian chapter was not able to prove that they are not foreign agents. So they want to talk. Okay, please introduce yourself and your issues.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? also work for the government and a bit of civil society. So I'm basically in the tech policy space, and just to comment on the whole issue of institutions and democratic deficiency, just like Harry said, most countries, especially even in East Africa, we have a problem where we might seem to have democracy, and of course what democracy is another whole discussion, right? Because what we regard as Africans as democracy might not be the same as, you know, in Russia or in the US. And I think this homogeneous way of telling everyone that democracy is popular vote is a fallacy, in my opinion, right? But other than that, in our country, we've come a long way in terms of developing our institutions. So in the early 200s, we had a scandal with the judiciary, and there was a lot of corruption happening, and that was slowly wiped out. And then the last 10 years, we had a problem with our executive in terms of our presidency and, you know, the kind of structures being put in place. And now recently, the quote-unquote, not really opposition, but part of the government that became the opposition, who was a former deputy president, is now the president of Kenya. And what I noticed was key in our country is that there are new institutions being developed, such as social media, which are even more active in terms of, holding people accountable, right? So a few years ago, I think 2 years ago, Mozilla did a research in Kenya and how misinformation and trolls were being literally funded every day to spread misinformation. And now there's been a bit of, there's more regulation in terms of how the Twitter spaces are being handled, in terms of how content is being moderated, which again we said is neither here nor there. But the internet has grown to be an institution in our country. We have literally, we call it KOT, Kenyans on Twitter, a whole opposition on their own. The last 10 years, we literally chased away our president from Twitter. He deactivated his Twitter account because people would always, you know, at him and hold him accountable and tell him to fix things. So that was something, you know, interesting in our country. Another development was we had our elections in August this year, and the body that does elections is called the Independent Electoral Body. It's an independent commission. But what they did this round that really, you know, showed the involvement of the internet is the fact that they would upload every single result from every single part of the country. And that's like around 40 plus counties, with basically thousands and thousands of forms, yeah, because every polling station. So that really helped because every single form was being uploaded online, and people would do their individual counts, NGOs would do their counts, the media would do their counts. And the final day, it was found that, you know, the counts added up. And then despite the fact that, you know, there was a sole loser, they went to the Supreme Court. Again, the judiciary showed the fact that it was a very independent institution and, you know, upheld the elections. So I think there's a lot of development also in terms of strengthening of this institution generally. So that's on a positive note. I think there's a lot of, you know.
Yeah, I may confess, if somebody became opposition being president before, you have much more democracy than in Russia. And you really have a good, strong set of NGOs and, well, organizations controlling elections. But what about internet? So which institutions may be missing? Or you think that in Kenya, in internet-related organizations who, for example, works with legislators about content moderation or fake news, is everything okay, you think?
Yeah, in terms of the... in terms of the institutions being there, all of them are represented. There's representations from all kinds of sectors. Now the question is, what is the impact of them being there, right? Because you'd see most of the NGOs and how they're funding, who's funding them is another question. What are their interests in terms of what they want to push, which agenda are they pushing this time? So I think in terms of the institutions being present, they're there. There are representations from all kinds of society. I think the question is, what is the impact of them being there, and how are they involving the public in the question? Yeah.
It's really the next level question. So exactly, yes. Let's hope for another IGF.
Yeah.
Let me give just a quick answer. I think that the only solution is possible exchange of the opinions on international level, and so it's possible to get it to get the best practices. So I think that the issue of foreign agents, like in Russian legislation, is absolutely cooperating and exchanging best practices.
Yeah, that's the different good example that Russian Gongokan came from opposition or foreign agent organized session. But in Russia, they will never even speak with me. So, okay, somebody from this part wanted, hands raised. Gentlemen on the left from, from VO group. Everything is okay in your countries?
Actually, the foreign agent law primarily in Russia is not for muting the voice. Can I please finish?
You're spreading
muting,
fakes. No, sorry. Sorry. This is kind of Russian foreign agent law. Is like
okay.
FARA in US
okay.
is actually spreading
yeah, okay.
fakes. Sorry.
And
please stop.
Actually, what we've changed and what we are focused to when implying this kind of law is to keep the abroad money away from our politics and to keep people not to involve. So
yeah,
can I finish, please?
Please, this micro.
Yeah.
Please pass this micro.
Really, I can't say anything about disinformation in Canada because I'm not like studying media landscape in Canada. So please speak about it if you have some issues, but speaking about foreign agents law in Russia, this was primarily to cut off the foreign involvement in Russian political issues. And I think it's
sorry,
kind of
it's really fake news. What? That's really
just
fake
news. Answer. Let's say why Canada is not a relevant example here, because in Canada, in case of disinformation, we have relevant. I am from Canada, actually. I'm from McGill University. In this case, we can apply to the court, and court will, we can rely that court will have a good decision, actually, fair decision. That is in Canada. But in other countries, the situation is quite different.
Yeah, please, microphone to gentleman at the back. I hope he have something to add about missing institutions, maybe in Canada, maybe in another country.
Yeah, it's on. Okay. So my point was that on the day that the SWIFT was turned off and Russians couldn't pay through the SWIFT anymore, at Facebook, 95% of disinformation disappeared from Facebook for the Canadians, right? That was all I have to say about that.
Yeah, okay, but which missing institution have not fixed this issue before? So what's needed to cut, for example, misinformation in Canada or stop funding from Russian media outlets and propaganda?
The conclusion was really that 95% of disinformation disseminated in Canada through Facebook was made by Russians.
Well, I feel that some of such organizations in this audience, yeah, not ever speak,
yeah.
But maybe.
And I think, okay, now that I have the mic, I think there's another thing here that, like, basically, you're asking, like, which institutions are missing. And I think especially, the Russians and the Turkey are probably good examples of where you would actually be forbid to make these kind of institutions. It's different to US, where you have the EFF and the Internet Society and so on. You have actually really great platforms for activism. But in maybe I'm wrong about Turkey, but in Russia, activism is really forbid. It's like you can't have a pirate party, you can't have Internet Society, so on. So, yeah.
Final note is that, I mean, we do have those organizations in Turkey, and I can definitely say that Russia is way more, I think, concerning than the Turkey civil society. We all, of course, have a lot of issues, but we, I mean, the thing is, when it comes to missing institutions and foreign money, I'm quite curious about what you would think about how the government using its own taxpaying money, how the government is using financing for issues about democracy. Is there any institution in Russia that kind of controls what Putin can do or can't do? Or is it just some regulations when it comes to foreign money, or can the just government take the taxes and do whatever they want? Is there an institution?
Like colleague said, there's war in Russia, and Putin actually fighting Russians for 20 years, and there is no institution which controls it. So it's like a Roman Empire's statement, and then maybe repeated by Machiavelli, that's everything for friends, but law is for enemies. So that's foreign agent law is for Putin's enemy, but not for his friends. That's unfortunately, we have to grow up civil society institutions, and they being cut at the roots very instantly. The more and more people becoming foreign agents, and more organizations becoming undesirable. So that's an issue. That answering your questions, but again, somebody else, maybe to join in. Yes, please. Ruled by friend of Mr. Putin. That's we actually ask. Yes, it works. Just start speaking.
Hi, so I'm Leena Rampainen from Electronic Frontier Finland, and since we were on the topic of money, and somebody I think mentioned earlier that Finland is great, well, not always. I mean, Finland still has a legislation that organizations like us should have a money collecting permit. And we are never going to get a permit. We have been in court once before about illegal money collecting just because we used to have our account number on the webpage with the mention that you may donate to us. And now we are doing the second round in the courts. But this probably dates back to the Tsarist era, because at that point, of course, everything wanted to be controlled. But Finland hasn't gotten rid of this legislation even to this day. And we did raise it in the United Nations Universal Process Review for Finland, because it's both us and the Extinction Rebellion supporting organizations that have now been slammed with this so-called illegal money collecting.
Yeah, okay, and the hand over there.
The United States and Canada and some other countries have some advantage in having relatively functional court systems, where, like, unlike Turkey with HDP or in Russia, opposition party members are not, you know, arrested forever just for being opposition party members. So I do think there is some difference. But it should also be pointed out that difference is not maybe as huge as it appears. So, for example, Canada, Canada's mining industry, Barrick Gold, has been, you know, very little doubt. There's lots of murder and torture of Africans in Tanzania and other places due to their gold mining. The Africans try to take them to court in Africa. The Canadian gold mining company refuses to listen to that court. Finally, maybe it goes to Canada and something happens. Likewise, you know, freedom of the press is guaranteed inside the United States. But like as the Julian Assange case shows, the United States government does not believe that freedom of the press should be guaranteed outside of the United States. Should only be guaranteed inside. And in terms of payments, you know, of course, some of the first early financial blockades done without any legal backing, without any juridical backing, were the cutoff of all donations to WikiLeaks by PayPal, Visa, MasterCard, the entire international financial system. So, you know, it's like I do think there are some qualitative advantages. I'd much rather live in the U.S. or Canada than Russia or Turkey by any chance. But you can see that the general progress is going pretty bad. I'm just going to object to the term misinformation, because I think every country has propaganda. Russia definitely has a lot of propaganda, I think is inarguable. But then so does the United States. Look at, for example, you know, Radio Free Asia, Voice of America, so forth and so on. This has been going on since World War II. Propaganda is a known problem, and I think it should be eliminated. But every nation state does it for their own best interests.
Well, difference for Canada and United States, that's you have much more possibilities to express yourself. And actually, when in United States, you can remember only one WikiLeaks, but the whole opposition and the weekly updated list of foreign agent is kind of really different from Western world and what we feel in Russia anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I've been to Russia, I've seen Russian protesters arrested instantly. I've also been in the United States and been arrested at American protests. After after a few hours. So, you know, I think it's there is a difference, but yeah, it's not maybe as black and white.
But I think how United States will slowly drift into Russia. Yes, that's an interesting discussion, but not for this location. Yeah, so actually we are still in United Nations premises. So we are discussing a deficit of democracy, we're discussing lack of institutions. But lucky for us, United Nations cares about us with their, well, sustainable development goals and now 2030 goals. And actually I would like to handle microphone to Andrew to, well, return us to this landscape from huge companies to United Nations and how they would like to help us.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I'd like to just mention actually what we are here about and the Sustainable Development Goal. On first of all, the goal 16, we are devoted on the indicization of devoted for this goal. Goal for the peace, justice and effective institutions. And as we know, the system of the Sustainable Development Goals could not be achieved. So we could not achieve one goal and not achieve another one. So all goals are related to each other. So even we can see, I can see internet example, internet governance track, for example, life underwater goal. I can see the internet governance track and so on in every goal of the SDGs. And so that and also the other feature of the Sustainable Development Goals. So we have to achieve them only in scope of international cooperation. We are talking here about the institutions in Russia, Turkey, Ethiopia, and Kenya, and U.S. and Canada. We are talking about the whole world, which facing the same problems, actually, that the humanity, the international community, and we have the space here to discuss it in the joint atmosphere of the global discussion, when it's possible to understand each other, when it's possible to promote best practices. We're not promoting the best practices, we're promoting the worst practices, for example, in some countries. But it's also a useful situation where we can exchange opinions to each other. And that's why I think that the issue related to Sustainable Development Goals, we should not forget about it. And this goal number 16, is absolutely relevant, also not only for internet governance issues, but internet governance issues could be also politics for promoting human rights, for promoting democracy in countries. So internet governance itself has the very huge potential of doing positive things, positive changes in all societies. But it's not possible, as it's not possible, as for my opinion, to fragment the internet, to make it fragmented. It's not possible to do it. Split it to different networks. The same situation with this global discussion. It is the puzzle that could be resolved only internationally, only with the international community. So we want to discuss first of all about the foreign agents. It is good to be foreign agent. It's good to represent interests. Maybe a foreign organization, maybe to make a bridge, not to make a wall, to make a bridge between cultures, between political activists and other things like that. And this is the issue we have to achieve. And let's not forget about the Sustainable Development Goals in this context. And I think this discussion is really important and relevant. And I think it's not the finish of discussion. It's just the beginning, the outbreak of discussion. And I could invite you and will share my contact. It's possible to share contact of the Free Moscow University. and we could continue our discussion in different fields and different spaces. For example, on the conference, I prefer in-person format, as I say, as we could also say with these issues. But I think so. We have a lot of places, but the IGF is the best one. Thank you very much.
Yeah, and let's finish on this very, very positive note. I think that discussion again about institution and education and cooperation should continue. Andrei is inviting us for a few Moscow University booths at IGF Village on your way to lunch, which I think will be just now. So thank you very much. I was really glad to hear really different opinions, even interventions from, well, our opposition in Russia, but programmable. Thank you very much. See you all next IGF, and maybe in 2 years in Russia also. Thank you.